Oh, it's Deserie.
My name is Sister Deserie, and I'm trying to bring up a ministry of dance to this church called The Stand, and I'm trying to reach the youth. But that doesn't mean I'm excluding the parents or older people either. Whatever message comes through, that's for you to hear. So, yeah.
Amen. Amen.
I just let the Lord use me, so.
Amen.
Yeah, I got it.
We ask that the Holy Spirit come down in the form of a dove upon you, Lord.
my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Lord, and you poured it out upon the church the day of Pentecost. That was the day of an explosive event. And today, God, as we endeavor to be endued by the power and indwelled by the power of the Holy Spirit, I ask that you begin to set free. I ask that you begin to deliver. I ask that you begin to empower the church, that we would work with the dunamis power of the Holy Spirit expressed upon our lives. In Jesus' name, can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to teach today something that I believe that we need to understand, that the Holy Spirit brings power to the church. Can you say amen?
Amen.
The Holy Spirit brings power to the church. See, God has this supernatural power, the Bible says, that he pours out upon the church. It is literally a power that is applied to the Word of God. It brings understanding. It brings teaching into our lives. It brings a joy to our hearts. And there is an energizing power for you and I to be empowered to do the works and the service of God through the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is real. The Holy Spirit is the triune part of God, the third part of the Trinity. And so the Holy Spirit is a power to the church. If you have an engine in a car, and I've seen some beautiful looking cars in my life, and that's what builds the power in the engine. But that car would never go unless you fill up that car with gas. And there is definitely something that we need to understand today, that we need the power of the Holy Spirit indwelling in our lives. Can you say amen?
Amen.
We need God's supernatural power, the dunamis power, the paraclete. There's over 50 different workings of the Holy Spirit in the Bible. And we need the endowment, the power of the Holy Spirit resting and in empowering us in our lives. I want you to say that this morning. Lord,
I need
the expression of the Holy Spirit empowering my life. I accept the empowerment. And I want you to endow me with the power of the Holy Spirit to be expressed through my life. Amen.
Amen.
We need the Holy Spirit in our lives. We need the Holy Spirit in the church. We need to be filled up with the Holy Spirit. And we also many times need to have a tune-up. Anybody know what a tune-up is?
Come on.
Is it when a car isn't working right and it's not activating right? And it's boom, boom, boom. And it's got a mess to it. It needs a tune-up. And what we need, the Bible says that we continually be filled with the expression of the Holy Spirit. That we would continually be renewed and tuned up in the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that God sent the Holy Spirit to empower and indwell the church. And so, it is Jesus who told this, listen to this. He said it is absolutely critical that the role of the Holy Spirit be the player in the church. It is absolutely critical that the role of the Holy Spirit be the one that empowers and be the player in the church. Jesus promised that the Spirit would come on the last night before the day of Pentecost, or when he was there with his men in the upper room. Jesus began to speak about it before he ascended. And he said, there is going to be a power. There's going to be something that is going to be released upon your life before the crucifixion. Jesus told the disciples, I want you to stay in Jerusalem. Don't go anywhere. Now, we used to call it tarry in the old days, where we go in and we tarry on the Word of God, and we tarry to hear from God through prayer. And we would press through prayer. And Jesus told them to stay in Jerusalem until you are endued or filled up or indwelled with the power of the Holy Spirit. And so the Bible says that they stayed there 10 days, and they were waiting upon the power of the Holy Spirit to come. And so he consecrated really to them. And he told them to concentrate on being sensitive to the Holy Spirit. How many know we're not to quench the Holy Spirit? And when you come into the church, you need to understand you need to be a receptacle for the Holy Spirit to flow through. And the problem with a lot of our lives is that we quench the Spirit by the way that we live our lives. We're not seeking after the Holy Spirit like we should. But the whole, let me tell you something. The Holy Spirit is a gentleman. I hope if you're a man here, a male here today, that when a woman is standing at the door, that you're a gentleman, you let him in.
Come on.
And the Holy Spirit is a gentleman. And he's saying, you know what? I am there for you. And I'm willing to open the door and release what you need upon your life. But you don't understand this, folks. We need to be gentlemen and begin to allow the Holy Spirit to come into the church and to come into our lives. There was a man that said, you know, I just don't fit into that church. They just don't want me in that church. He was crying out to God, and God said, you know what? That's okay. They don't want me either. And I don't want to be a church like that. That depends upon my own individual knowledge, word, the increase of knowledge. How many know that you can have all the knowledge, have everything that, as far as knowledge is concerned, but have no power of the Holy Spirit resting in your life? You can be a person that had all the words. You have it all down. You have every dot, every tittle. You have it all down. You have it all together. You're a very knowledgeable man or woman of God in the Word of God. But you can still not have the power of the Holy Spirit resting in your life. We need the Holy Spirit. We need the Holy Spirit in the church. And now listen to this. If you have no spirit, you have no power. If you have no spirit, you have no power. No power, no spirit. Now, just before the ascension, Jesus told them that there was a great promise in the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 8. The Bible says, but you shall receive power. The word power means dunamis power, dynamite power. That you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And listen to this. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. In other words, the Holy Spirit wants to come upon you. And you shall be a witness in me of Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and unto the ends of the earth, of the uttermost ends of the earth. Before they ever went out outside of the boundaries that Jesus had discipled them for 3.5 years in, he told them there is something that you're going to need, that's going to need to be a provision in your life. It's going to empower you to be able to take the gospel out of Jerusalem and out of Judea and out of this area, out of Israel. There's something that you're going to need upon your life. If the church is going to be explosive, you're going to need to wait in Jerusalem, because I'm sending something to you. I'm sending something to the church. I'm sending something to you folks here today. And it is an infilling power of the dynamite power of God that will be explosive in the church, that will reach out beyond the boundaries where it is now, and you will be a vessel through which the power works. Now, the promise is fulfilled. They waited 10 days. How many know sometimes we need to wait upon God? We need to have a voice to listen to his voice. And now Jesus was promising something, and even though he'd been with them 3.5 years, and they had watched his ministry, they had been taught by him, but he says this is something that is going to be foundational to you, because you are going to be the stones that build the church. Now, if you study, in other words, the disciples, the 12 disciples, you're going to be the avenue in which you need to receive the power so you can go out and evangelize the earth. How many understand that they did do that? That the earth has been evangelized. I don't know why, but recently I had all these people, just one after another, after another, after another, want to be my friends from other countries. And they want to talk to me. And they want me to go on the internet and preach to them. They want me to do this, and they want me to do that. And anybody ever have that? And they're calling, they're texting me, and you know what? How many know that God wants to use our life as an expression of the Holy Spirit wherever you work at, wherever you go, wherever you go into the grocery store, wherever you go? God wants to use your life as an expression of the Holy Spirit to reach others and branch out the name of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And so it is with our lives. So it was there the day of Pentecost that they had all the information of the things that the Lord had taught them. He's the greatest Bible teacher that there ever was. But he tells them there is something else that you desperately need. I was in prayer this morning, and I feel great. I was in this room by myself, and I began to break out in the heavenly language. And I almost felt like God was telling me, and really impressed it in my heart, that what you need to begin to focus on is teaching with the expression of the Holy Spirit to the church. Because too many of us walk with a power that is powerless. Powerless. When God wants to give you more power, He wants to give you the supernatural power to overcome. Some of you are facing things in your life because God is saying, I want you to tap into my supernatural power so you can overcome the things that you're facing in your life. How many know that we serve a supernatural God that works supernaturally in the church, and God wants to fill you up with the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete, the teacher? He wants to empower your life. He wants you to make a difference in this world. He doesn't just want you to come to church on Sunday, but He wants you to go outside of the doors of this church and be an expression of the power, the supernatural power of God in a world that is lost and dying. He wants to pour out His Spirit upon you. He wants you to be able to speak with other tongues. He wants you to be able to lay hands upon the sick and see them recover. He wants a prophetic word to the church. And today, the prophetic word to the church today is jump into the fire and receive the supernatural outpouring of the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit in your life. Can somebody say amen?
Amen. Amen.
You see, too many today walk with a great education. Oh, they got a great expression. They're good. You know what? And that's all good. That's a great thing. We need to be taught the Word of God and be taught. But I want to show you something. Jesus told the disciples that you're lacking something still. There is still something lacking in your life. The reason why you haven't had the breakthrough that you want is because there's going to be something that's going to come upon you after I leave. And it is expression of the Holy Spirit that will be worked out of your life to this world. In Acts 1, chapter 4, verse 5, the Bible says, and being assembled together with them, He commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which He said, you have heard from Me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. I already told you, they waited 10 days. Now let's go to the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 1. They waited 10 days on the Holy Spirit. And eventually they were in the upper room on the day of Pentecost. So let's pick it up in Acts, chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all, say the word all, with one accord in one place. They weren't scattered all over, but they came together in prayer. There's something powerful when we seek God and we come together in prayer. I know we have breakfast on over there in the morning, but I think we're lacking something. I think we need to get over here after we eat, get over here, get a cup of coffee, and get over here and get into prayer so we can receive the outpouring of God. I'll tell you something, folks. We need the Holy Spirit operating in our lives and in our church. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You know what? I need it more than anything else. God is beginning to show me some things. An expression of the Holy Spirit is that He wants us to be a supernatural people doing supernatural things.
Amen.
I want to see the sick healed.
Amen.
I want to see people delivered.
That's right.
We went on an outreach about a week ago that knocked on the door. There was a woman. The moment I knocked on her door, I'm going to go back over there. And at that moment, they told us to leave the property. Isn't it funny? You can go out peddling everything, but when you start preaching Jesus Christ, they tell you to stop. And I'm knocking on the door. How many know that's the enemy? And I'm knocking on the door. She's the final one. And when she opens the door, I said, I'm Pastor so-and-so. I'm from so-and-so church. I want to invite you out to our church. And she said, I used to go to church. I used to wear the full gear. I was in the Salvation Army. She goes, I just was praying about God to show me a place to go. She says, my husband, he's been in prison for 2 years. And she begins to weep and begins to cry. And I can't tell you how many times that when we go, how many know we are not just called just to come and be comfortable in the church, but we are called to take the gospel outside of the church.
Amen.
You're called to take it to your neighbor. You're called to take, you know what, this church would be filled up if we would get busy and do what we're supposed to do. If we would get busy and begin to speak to people, instead of being shy, how many's ever felt like the Holy Spirit told you, talk to this person over here?
Amen.
And you look and you're thinking, well, that's just me. No, I can't do it. I mean, I used to drive my wife nuts. We'd go out to eat, and people were trying to have dinner, and I'd have flyers in my pocket. And we're eating at a fancy restaurant. She's like, you spend some time with me. But God would say, hey, see that guy over there? And so I would mosey over there, and I'm like, how you doing, buddy? I just want to give you a flyer. I want to tell you something. Jesus loves you. You know, it's something like that. You would think something simple like that doesn't mean a lot. But if you stay sensitive to the Holy Spirit, how many know we miss a lot of opportunities because we're not in tune with the Holy Spirit?
That's right. Amen.
We miss a lot of opportunities because we battle against the Holy Spirit with our flesh because we want to resist what the Holy Spirit wants to do in our lives. And I'm here to tell you today, I make a proclamation to the church here, Community Christian Center, that God wants you to begin to proclaim what He has in your life. He wants to supernaturally endow you with the power of the Holy Spirit, but you need to tap in to the power of God.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
Through prayer. On the day of Pentecost, that was the church's birthday. The Bible says that they were all filled. They were in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. I pray that that will happen here, that it will fill the whole church where you are sitting. Then there appeared unto them divided tongues as a fire that sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now when we look at this, the day of Pentecost was really the church's birthday. It was the power that was actively working through the Holy Spirit. It brought the church into being who the church is today. The Holy Spirit was poured out upon the church, and the Bible says that the Spirit's presence was manifested by wind and fire and a powerful invasion from heaven to the disciples like they'd never known before. They began to speak words and they didn't know what they were saying, but they were literally speaking out words that were in other people's languages. Amen. Hallelujah. I really believe, truly believe. There used to be this guy that came to our church on the very first Praise Chapel that was ever up here. It was on Yucca Street on 16,000 block, and he was from Mexico. We gave him a little house. We let him stay in it. It's where we did our breakfasts and things, and he stayed in there, and I can't remember his name, but for some reason, I was able to converse with him. Amen. My wife says, how do you learn that? I don't know. I just listen. And I pay attention. And he was so happy to be in the church. And he could speak very little English. But there was an expression, and you know what the expression is? You don't have to know somebody completely. The Holy Spirit already knows them.
Come on.
He already knows about them.
Mm-hmm.
He already knows what they're going through. He already knows what they need in their life. And He can use you. You don't have to identify with everything that everybody else has gone through. I had a problem when I was a young man. I felt like I had to find something to identify. Like the Bible says that Paul became all things to all men in the manner that he might win some, that he might win them over. He built a bridge. He found some way, some common ground that he can reach them. But it doesn't mean you have to be part of their testimony. You don't have to reach in and do what they do. Amen. I was never a gangbanger. I was never a drug addict. I was never an alcoholic. But I wasn't a goody two-shoes. And God used me the way I am. I started a Bible study, and these men started coming to my house, and every one of them were ex-convicts. I wasn't an ex-convict. I didn't have anything. But the Holy Spirit in me had something that was going on in that relationship with those men. There is a Holy Spirit. There is a supernatural Holy Spirit that wants to break through the bondages in your life, that wants to deliver you from all the things that have had you down. When you go to court, amen, the Holy Spirit can go with you, amen. When you go to school, amen, the Holy Spirit can go with you. When you go to the marketplace, the Holy Spirit can go with you.
Yeah.
But we've got to tap into the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit in the church today. And I'm here to tell you, it's available right now.
Right.
Amen.
I am on fire today. outpouring of fire that rested. There was a mighty rushing wind that ripped through that upper room, and there was fire that rested upon each of them, and it was the igniting power that was given to the church. It was a birth of the supernatural power that was released upon your life today, but you've got to tap into it.
Yes, amen.
Religion won't do it. You can come to church all you want. Amen. You can sit here every week and say, amen, preacher. You can go through all the religious calisthenics. You can know the Word of God frontwards and backwards. You can be a theologian and still not be tapped into the Holy Spirit. You've got to rely. It's not your power. The reason why many of us get burnt out, the reason why people quit going to church and run away from God, is because they try to do it on their own and they haven't tapped in to the supernatural power of God and rely upon Him.
Yes, amen.
What we need today is to tap in. To tap in. God is saying to you today, when is the last time that you tapped in to my supernatural power? When is the last time you got down upon your knees and cried out for a Holy Ghost outpour upon your life? When is the last time you got down on your knees and began to weep before God and say, God, I need it in my life? When was the last time you got so filled up with the Holy Spirit, you were like a sponge, it was just pouring into you, and man, God wanted you to wring that sponge out and give it to the world, amen, but you dried up inside and you let it go? When was the last time you allowed the Holy Spirit to express Himself in and through your life?
Yes, amen.
When was the last time? You can come to church, you can do everything, you can be the greatest preacher that ever lived. You can do that, all that, and that's great. I'm not belittling that, because we need all that stuff. But the Bible says He told them, He was with them 3.5 years, teaching them, showing them ministry, healing the sick. Blind eyes were open, ears were open, the lame were able to walk, amen. And everything, and Jesus said, there is still something that you're lacking. He says, I want you to wait. Come on, somebody. Come on now. Get ready. Amen. I want you to wait, because there's something that's about to be poured out upon your life. There's something that's going to be supernatural, that is going to empower your life. You're going to do things that you've never done before. And they began to speak languages that they weren't taught. They began to speak languages they didn't know about. And the Bible says that all the Medes and Persians and all those people that were around said, I don't know, aren't they Galileans? Aren't they fishermen? Don't they have other occupations? But we hear them speaking in our language the wonderful works of God.
Amen.
It's the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit. Tap in. How many ever felt like your tank's running low?
Come on.
You ever been in a car that's running out of gas? You know what? It's amazing how God works sometimes. How many have ever felt your car running out of gas? You said the gas station just right up the street. And you can feel it. Oh, it's on red. Oh, God, help me get there. Oh, God, help me get there. And you come to the realization that you're out of gas when the car starts to sputter. There are a lot of sputtering Christians today. There's some here right now. Amen. I need gas. It's not working. Engine's about ready to clunk. It's clunking, man. It's taking the junk up off the bottom now. Amen. How many know that a lot of times, you know, where does residue go when it goes through water? To the bottom. How many know catfish dwell on the bottom? They're bottom level eaters. Amen. Hallelujah. And you know what? God didn't call you to be a catfish Christian. Amen. He didn't call you to dwell in the sediment on the bottom. He called you to swim on the top. Amen. He called you to be on the top. He called you to have a full tank. And what He says is that you continually need to be indwelled and brought in to the supernatural power of God. And the only way to do that is when they got in the upper room and they began to pray out and they asked God, we want that Holy Spirit. We want whatever you were talking about to come upon us. We need it. You said we need it. We need it now. And you know what happened? Listen to this. Amen. When they got, oh God, hallelujah. When they got the Holy Spirit, They walked down out of the room. Peter was filled with the Holy Spirit. Can you imagine this? And he begins to preach to them. And there was something different this time. Because when Peter preached to them, the Bible says that they were cut to the heart. You ever got in prayer and begin to talk to somebody? Amen. You don't know what, you know it wasn't you, but God used you at a moment to say something to somebody, and their Bible says that their hearts were pricked, that they were cut to the heart. That's called conviction. How many know we ought to have a little bit of conviction that rub off on other people? There ought to be something in your life that makes other people say, man, you know what? That guy's different. The moment you start looking like other people, you better take a look in the mirror and put yourself in check.
Come on.
Say amen on me.
Amen.
I'll never finish all this. Never do. But this is different. This is different. God hasn't called us just to come and to be comfortable in the church. God hasn't called us just to be here and just float around like a floating cell in the body of Christ. God has called us out into a venture. God has called us out into the deep. God has called us out into more. And many of us, we've only tapped just a little bit in. He wants you to wade out into the deep. The Bible says that there are 50 different works that is said theologians of the Holy Spirit. We could teach on that. But in Acts chapter 2, verse 5, the Bible says, after they were dwelling in Jerusalem, Jews, devout men, and every nation under heaven, and when the sound occurred, a multitude came together, and they were confused because everyone heard them speak in their own language. And then they were all amazed and marveled, saying unto one another, look at all this. Are not all these that speak Galileans? And how is it that we hear each one of them in the language that we were born? Parthians and Medes and Elamites and those of dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, and Pontus and Asia and Phrygia and Pamphylia and Egypt and parts of Libya joining Cyrene. Visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them speaking in our own tongue the wonderful works of God.
Amen.
See, they were able to do something that they had never done before because they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And let me say this, church, we need this in the church today. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
We need it in our lives. It's not a program. It's not a seminar. It's not all our knowledge, but it's the power of the Holy Spirit. We need a fresh indwelling, fresh outpour of the Holy Spirit upon our lives as Christians so we can be impacted with the gospel. See, we aren't to replace the Spirit with programs. How many have ever done that? We aren't to replace the Spirit with programs. Well, let's just go to another conference. Conferences are good. Well, let's go. I would hear that. Oh, there's a healer that's preaching over down in Los Angeles. We're all going to go down there because he has a gift. And you know what God is saying? Listen. And I'm not negating that because there's people that God does use. And I love that. If God uses somebody like that, awesome. But God says to you, tap in. What are you waiting for? Have you ever been on a hot summer day and seen a swimming pool and wish you owned it? There's a couple doors down. I told my wife, I want to buy that house. She says, why? I said, well, we're just renting this one, a couple of doors down. I heard it's got a pool and it's salted. And she says, no, you're not going to move in that house. We're not going to move in there. I kept thinking we're going to buy the house. Somebody else bought it the other day. Well, of course, me, you know, I mean, how many ever get curious? I saw a lot, because they kind of sneakily sold that house. And I walk over there because I'm looking like, somebody else moving into that house? And I'm looking and I think, somebody's in that house already. They bought it. So I walk back. And anybody ever kicked the ground a little bit and said, man, shucks, I should have bought it. You know what I'm saying today? We don't have to be shucking Christians. You need to quit shucking and jiving God. You need to quit thinking you can run it over on God. You know what? Many times we're not operating the way we should as a church. There's a power that needs to be in your life, and it's available for you. If you have studied the scripture, when they went into the tabernacle, that when they, if you think about the whole thing, there was a gate that went all the way around the tabernacle. And the tribes of Israel encamped all the way around the camp. And the power of God dwelled in the Holy of Holies. Isn't that right? And they would have to go past the gate. And when they went past the gate was over 7 feet tall. And it had badger skins. It was all these different skins. How many know the Bible says that Jesus says, I am the gate? And so they walk in, and when you walk in, you would see the Levitical priesthood that were in there, and they were doing sacrifices every day. So it was, how many know the gospel talks about blood? Mm-hmm. The Bible says if it wasn't for the shedding of the blood, there would remain no more remission of sin. It was already a type, or what they call a double reference, or a prophetic word, that Jesus Christ would die a bloody death in the Old Testament. And so they would walk up to what they call the brazen labor. In that brazen labor, they would make sacrifices of the animals, and the priest would walk up, and there would be blood all over them. And in that brazen labor, there was mirrors that were inside that brazen labor. And as they begin to wash the blood off, the Bible says it is washed by the regeneration of the Word, that they would literally see their skin become clean because they washed it off. And then the priests that would go in, because they couldn't go into the Holy of Holies, but they can go into the holy place. And so they'd walk in the holy place. We understand it was Aaron's rod that budded. There were three different elements in there. Amen. And they would go in there, and they would make sacrifice, and they would go in there for the sins of mankind. But once a year, there was what they called the most holy place. And there was a veil across that. And nobody was allowed to go into the presence of God except once a year. And that they would pick out one of the Levitical priests, and they would literally tie a rope to his leg and say, now you can go in. And he had done the blood sacrifice, and he'd walk in, he would go past the veil into the power, where the power of the super, there would actually be a fire that would rest upon it. Man, can you imagine that if that was in a church? Amen. You got so on fire. This has happened before. Literally, there was a church that was so on fire one time that the fire department went there. If I don't know if you guys read about it. And there was a supernatural fire of the Holy Spirit. They called the fire department. They came and they said, we've seen a fire, but wasn't no fire. Amen. It was the people getting a hold of God.
Amen. Yes. Yes.
And there was a supernatural fire past that veil. And that priest, he couldn't have any sin in his life. None at all. And they would tie a rope on his leg with bells. And he would walk in. And man, I would probably almost stick my toe in, because if you're not right, you're going to die. Mm. So I'm the type of person that stick my toe in. Is it okay? I stick my tongue in. Oh, okay. It's so good so far. I stick my nose. Okay. And then they would walk in and they would bring sacrifice before the Lord. And those bells represented, if they stopped ringing, it means that they'd have to pull the priest out because he had sin in his life, and God would cast him down dead right there. But how many know that we serve a live God? And he no longer dwells in temples that are made by man's hands. And the Bible says that he indwells in you now. The same new supernatural power that can cleanse the world of its sin now dwells in you. He says, I no longer dwell in vessels that are made by man's hands, but I dwell in an individual's heart. I am in your soul. But you have to understand that it was a power that guided Israel for 40 years. When they were in the dark, there was a light by night that guided them. When they were in the sun, there was clouds that kept the scorching heat from burning them. The Bible says, oh man, hallelujah, that even the soles of their feet never wore out for 40 years. Amen. That's a God of provision. Amen. Can somebody say amen? Amen. That is a Savior that is there. How many understand this? You need to tap in that you serve a God that is able to do anything that you need in your life. You need finances, amen, he can do it. You need a cloud over you to take the rays from burning you, he can do it. You need warmth at night, he can do it. But you've got to tap in.
That's right.
When the veil was taken away, that's where the Holy Spirit was. How many know we dwell? We are the temples of the Holy Spirit now.
Yes.
You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Say amen.
Amen.
Let's stand up. Hallelujah. 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 Yes, we can. Hallelujah. Today, God, Holy Spirit, wonderful God, wonderful Spirit of God, show it in the Kia Roma Haya Nikiti. Yoraba Haya Nikiata Neti Kia Roma Sadly Nikiti. It's your time. It's your time. Tap into it. Holy Spirit, fall down upon this church. Fall down upon the lives of God's people. Father, we come to you. Nothing is impossible. Peter went outside, was empowered by the Holy Spirit, began to preach the word, and they were cut to the heart. And over 2,000 souls were saved instantly. And that's what we need. There was a supernatural expression that came through the church that automatically over 2,000 souls were saved instantly.